This is the Ron Perti Show.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the program. I hope you're having a great holiday season. My guest today was part of last year's Blank Fest and has been in the music scene since, I think if I remember correctly, all the readings I had to do, the mid-80s. You might know him from bands Silkworm and Mint Mile and so many others. We're definitely going to talk about the video I saw. I think it's a KEKP where he's the only member of the band with hair. It had to be very, 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 very confusing when it came to who was sleeping where on tour. But ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, Tim Midyett. Tim, thank you so much for being on the program.
Absolutely. Thanks for asking me.
No, I actually was scared to ask you. But Conan, our mutual friend Conan Neutron, was like, just ask him. So I did.
No, I'll talk to most people, you know. And plus you seem like a good guy and you come highly recommended.
Well, hey, if Conan says I'm okay, then right on.
That's right.
Yeah, so how are things now? Because it seems like COVID was dying off a little bit and now it's worse.
Sure.
And I know you're in the Midwest like I am, and numbers seem to be going up through the roof. Are you guys staying safe down there?
I know probably 10 people in the last 2 weeks who've gotten COVID. So the new thing is like the Omicron, or Comic-Con as we call it in the house.
The Transformers from the movie.
Yeah, a Comic-Con or Emma Crombie and Fitch. it's bad for sure. I mean, it's catchy. It's real, real catchy. It's definitely weird because they're all vaccinated. All these people I know, they're not, most of them aren't boosted. None of them that I know of. So that's probably part of it. But yeah, you kind of thought maybe it was going to go away in the middle of the summer, and then not enough people got vaccinated. And, we didn't vaccinate the whole world. And that's really what you kind of have to do to get rid of it quickly.
Right.
We're not going to get rid of it the fast way, where it's going to have to burn through some more of us. So we'll see. I haven't gotten it.
Being in the Midwest, that it would be so much easier for people to be like, to have that down home kind of like, you know what? Yeah, it's probably best for everybody that we do this. And then the Midwest seems to be some of the worst.
Yeah. I mean, well, the southern part of Illinois is basically the South. So there's that kind of whatever mentality there. You're not going to have anybody tell you what to do. And I don't know. It's just so weird to me that it became this political thing. Everyone's been vaccinated against something pretty much, you know,
right,
if you're of a certain age, and clearly none of us that I know of have grown horns or tails or anything. So, you know,
I'm going to hide this one that I grew, but you know,
yeah. it's just the weirdest hill to die on, literally sometimes die on. But I don't know. I kind of developed like this weird sympathy for people, mostly people who are immunocompromised and have to deal with people not doing what they should do,
right,
you know, in terms of getting vaccinated and stuff, but also just anybody who's into, people who are anti-vax. Like, I think people are just weak and they're just grasping at straws because they don't know what the hell to do, you know. And it's been a super weird 4 or 5 years, obviously, everything that's happened, well, very nearly sliding into fascism. And
it's like Trump was so bad. It's like, how could things get any worse? Oh, I know.
yeah, big pandemic. I'm just glad it didn't happen a year or two earlier. You know, it would have been a lot worse, I think. So I don't know.
I often wonder if Obama was president when this happened, if it would have gotten nearly as bad as it was.
Yeah, I don't know. Probably not. I don't know. It's hard to say, man.
Yeah,
I
mean, if ifs and buts were candy and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas.
Yeah, you hope it's one of these every 100 years things, but we'll see how it plays out.
Well, Betty White will still be there. Betty White will still be there.
But, that's right.
Now let's go back in time. You were born, if I remember correctly, in Missoula, Montana.
Yeah, I was born in Haver, Montana, on the High Line up north, but I didn't live there very long. And then after bouncing around a bit when I was a kid, we ended up in Missoula. I think I was probably, I want to say 8, 9 or 8 maybe when we moved there. So yeah, I lived in Missoula though. I grew up there. You know, that's my hometown.
Did Missoula have a big impact on do you like how, who you are now, do you think? Or was it, you know, like after a certain point you bounced, you're like, I'm going to Seattle.
It did have a big impact on me because it's less like this now because there's the internet and it's 2021 and stuff. But back then it was really pretty isolated. It was a college town, so, and still is. So, you know, it has the advantage of having people floating in there from all over the place. It's kind of a crossroads, you know, it's on I-90 between Minneapolis and Seattle. So it's kind of a little bit of a nexus there. People who ran drugs would go through there all the time, at least, and stuff. So there was, So there was a little bit of, there's a little bit of cultural stuff kind of seeping in from whatever, from the college kids and people just end up there. It's sort of a vortex, you know. It's like a lot of college towns are like that, where it draws people in and then they just kind of end up being there for the, you know, 40 years or whatever. But the isolation of it definitely had a lot to do with, for me, I think, with the way I ended up learning how to play music and, you know, the kind of mishmash of stuff that me and my friends gravitated towards, you know.
And it's where Silkworm came from, you know, so it's like you can't really shit on Missoula because then, you know, and that's the thing I noticed is that there are, like, in the trailer for the documentary, there's someone who basically told Pavement to go fuck themselves. They were there to see you guys. And I was like, I mean, I'm kind of on that team. I like Pavement, but if I had a chance to see Silkworm, I go see Silkworm. And Silkworm is one of those bands where you think, oh, I'm not familiar with them, but then you hear a couple songs and you're like, oh, okay, I know. You know, it's one of those things. Do you still notice that? I mean, what are your thoughts on, like, people who are still that committed to the band that, you know, I mean, you haven't done anything since 2005? I mean, obviously, I know why, but, you know.
Yeah. No, it's cool. It's great that it had legs. I thought it would, you know, back then I thought it would, even though, you know, we weren't, you know, the kind of traction that we got when we were in Seattle was very minimal. And it wasn't until we started touring that we kind of found our people in various places, you know, mostly in like Chicago and San Francisco and New York, but much more so than we had in Seattle, although we had, you know, a lot of good pals there and stuff. So, you know, but even at the time when we were kind of scuffling and trying to get opening gigs for bands in Seattle, and instead playing for like five people at the Ditto Tavern or whatever, I always felt like what we were doing was good, you know, and that was enough at the time. And the rare occasions when we thought about what it might all mean or whatever, which didn't happen that often, I just thought, you know, people are going to be listening to this music in 20 years, and here it is, you know, 30 years later, really. And they are still, you know, the records still have an audience and all that. So it's great. I'm very pleased by it. And I think it holds up, you know, when I go back and listen to that stuff.
I remember when you did Blank Fest last year, and the guy I do Blank Fest with is a little bit older, so he's been around a little bit more. And the minute you started playing Great Combine, he texts me and he's like, holy shit. And I'm like, you didn't know. He's like, oh my God. Like, you see so many bands over your time when you run a club, and like, he goes out with bands and he tours as like their merch guy and stuff like that. So he sees so many bands that after a while you just forget. You know, I think, and it's just that's what's great about music, is it's like this.
Yeah,
you know, it brings it jars your memory.
Well, it's you know, that's great. You know, it's nice when you hear stuff that resonates with you, because, like you said, there's a lot of stuff is just kind of it becomes noise after a while, especially if you book a club or like if you're on tour and you're just playing with local bands night after night. But then every now and then someone will be on their bill and you'll be like, wow, you know, there'll be something about it that resonates with you. So that's always great. That's great to hear. That's good.
I'm not going to lie. I love the original version of Great Combine, but I love the acoustic version. That it was just
good. Cool.
That was great. So good.
Thanks.
Do you mind if I play that at the end of the episode?
Oh no, I don't care. That's fine.
Perfect. Oh, the camera's over there. I keep moving it, hey, do I want to be like Howard Stern today or no? So growing up in Missoula, were your parents musical people, or did it just kind of did you hear a band and it just kind of stuck with you?
My dad played trumpet when he was a kid, and he was a good trumpet player. He
totally explains by the time I came around.
Yeah. And he probably had some of the older Miles records, from the 50s and stuff. He probably wasn't on board with the stuff that I like the most, the later 60s stuff. But he probably wasn't listening to it by that point. But he was a good trumpet player. My mom was musical in a very kind of casual way, like she taught Sunday school and stuff. So, but she could sing, and she actually sang for a long time in a barbershop chorus in Missoula. I mean, and in other towns where we lived, Helena and Big Fork. So she has a good voice, baritone singer. So yeah, they are musical, but in kind of a, I wouldn't say super casual way, but not as an avocation, more as a just something that enriched their lives kind of naturally and stuff. So, right. Yeah. I did. I mean, I grew up around music. They didn't have a lot of records or anything, but there were records around the house, and I certainly grew up listening to my dad's old 45s. He had this little box of old 50s 45s, Buddy Holly and Jerry Lee Lewis and Little Richard and stuff. And I listened to that stuff all the time when I was a kid, before I even started buying LPs on my own.
Yeah. My little brother is about 10 years younger than me. Mom took a break after me. She's like, no, I can't. and he is, if you put a gun to his head, he wouldn't listen to new stuff. He would much rather, when Jack White put out that Sun Records box set of singles, he wanted it so bad. He's like, that's the kind of music he listens to. He's into Johnny Cash, Frank Sinatra, which is another weird kind of aside, mm-hmm. but whatever. Mm-hmm. You dig what you dig, right? And you mentioned baritone. In the performance at KEKP with Bottomless mm-hmm. Pit, you were playing a baritone guitar.
KEXP.
KEXP, yes. You were playing a baritone guitar, were you not?
Yeah, that's mostly what I play. That's my thing that I do more. I play baritone guitar and I play bass. Yeah. I almost never play. If I play a regular guitar, I tune it down.
You've just become my friend's favorite musician, because he is a big fan of the baritone guitar. He's a really good bass player, and he recently discovered the bass six.
He
loves the bass six.
The bass six is the perfect sweet spot between that, because you can play it like in that Beatles documentary that just came out. A lot of the bass on that stuff is bass six, because if someone besides Paul was playing it, it's easier for a guitar player to play it, right? It's shorter scale length and stuff, and it's got six strings on it. But you can tune it either down like a bass, or you can tune it like a baritone guitar. So it works either way. Yeah.
Tech talk. You're on the Ron Pertee Show.
It's a good instrument. But yeah, that's the scale length is what does it. It's just the right length to do either one. And I started playing baritone on a regular scale guitar when in probably 95, and then eventually gravitated towards, actual purpose-built baritone guitars, and I have a whole bunch of them now. So
they are a fantastic instrument.
Yeah, I like it. And with my voice, I don't like the guitar is a little up into my vocal range. So the cool thing about baritone is it kind of lives below where I would naturally sing, and it just feels better to me as a thing to do.
Well, it sounds great. So, I mean, if it sounds good, why try and mess with it, right?
Yeah. Plus I have bass player fingers, which are all geccoed out, because they're all bulbous from playing bass. So there playing a regular guitar is kind of
That's perfect. Then there you go. When you were in Missoula, I know you were in a band. I'm the name is escaping me, but you were in a band before Silkworm that became Silkworm.
Einheit.
Yes.
Yeah. Band called Einheit. Yeah.
How did Silkworm come to be? Now, because this is your first time on the show, we got to get a little background just for the people who don't know what's going on. I'm trying to spread the word.
Talk about it.
How did How did Silkworm become a thing out of Einheit?
Well, Einheit was the first good band I was in, and I mean, I was in a couple like kind of Training Wheels bands, and then Einheit was a real band with people who were older than us. Joel, when I say us, I mean me and Andy Cohen and Ben Kustra, who were some of the original members of Silkworm, and Joel Phelps was in Einheit, and Joel started. He really started Silkworm. So anyway, we met Joel. We learned a lot from playing with him, and we learned a lot from the other older guys in the band. These guys, John Kappas and Tom Kipp, who are still good friends of mine. And Tom, sort of on the aesthetics front, introduced me to a lot of music, records and stuff. And John kind of on how to sort of more, maybe on how to conduct yourself and what mattered when it came to being in a band, you know. And what mattered wasn't what anybody else thought. It was just what the band wanted to do. And, you know, that kind of insular mindset, you know, inward looking kind of force that has guided everything I've done till now, you know, for better or worse. Right. I think when it comes to creative stuff, I like what I'm doing now just as much as anything I've ever done. I mean, everyone's going to have a different opinion about that, but I think it's just as good now. And it wouldn't have lasted that long without that focus, you know, inward focus. But it definitely, it's not a commercial thing, you know. It's not friendly to that kind of thing at all, which is fine. But you know, that is the trade-off.
But I think even though it's not commercial, I mean, you've obviously touched a ton of people, you know. Yeah. And I think that might be worth more than, well, okay.
Yeah.
maybe worth more is the wrong term here. Yeah. It means more to
it does. Yeah.
People.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I've told this story a few times of when I first heard the first Velvet's record. And I didn't know anything about Lou Reed or whatever. And I guess I was probably 15. It was before they got reissued, whatever year that was, 84 or 5, they got reissued. But it was before that. So it was an original copy of the first record. And I just, it looked cool. So I just, on a flyer, took it home. Oh, no, I'd read about it because I liked Psychedelic Furs a lot. Still like them a lot. And they were talking about the Velvets. So I was like, oh, that must be good if they like it. So I took it home and I listened to it like 5 or 6 times in a row. You know, I couldn't believe this record. It was just like nothing I'd ever heard before. And it was amazing. It still might be my favorite record or one of them. So then the next day I went back to work and someone was like, hey, how's it going? There were a couple good, few guys hanging out. And I was like, oh, it's going great. I just heard the Velvet Underground for the first time last night. And one guy goes, oh yeah, Lou Reed, you know, and that was it. Nothing. Oh, yeah. So I realized at that moment, like, I wonder if there's some disconnect between the way what I'm hearing or what I'm thinking is cool and what is generally accepted as being, you know, what like these guys listen to, I don't know, Los Lobos and stuff like that, you know? So, which is fine. There's nothing wrong with them, but, you know, I guess what I'm getting at is like, for all of us, this goes for Andy Cohen and Joel, who were in Silkworm and still make music. There's just a way we think about things and listen to things, and the way things hit us, it's just a little bit off of the way most people hear stuff, I think. It's not, and so if someone else does hear things the same way we hear them, I think our music has a really big impact on them, you know, which is why we don't have Silkworm doesn't have casual fans, you know.
Yeah.
They're either into it, really into it, or they're totally not. You know?
They're either on par with getting a restraining order because they're outside of your house, you know, or they're just like, okay, that makes sense. That makes complete sense.
Whatever. Sounds like something that sounds like Pavement or whatever. Yeah.
No, don't cut your hair, please. But okay. So now you guys met Steve Albini in a very weird way.
Yeah.
Could you talk about that for a little bit?
I first met, Steve went to the same high school me and Andy did. And, so we had, and he was sort of notorious for being a gadfly and and irritants, fairly widespread irritant at the school.
Sound like him at all.
Yeah. So, I of course knew about his music starting with the first Big Black EP, Lungs, when that came out, you know, cause he gave them to a few people in Missoula who were utterly befuddled by it. But, you know, we heard that stuff and we thought it was cool and we liked it. So, I guess the first time I met Steve, I was in college at Northwestern, which coincidentally is where he went to school. So he went there for journalism. I went there for theater. It's really very good school for both those things. And that's, I guess, why we went to it. But anyway, he wasn't there anymore. He's 5 or 6 years older than me, 5 years, 6. So his band Rape Man was playing a show in the basement of his house. I think it might've been their first show ever. And I heard about it and I went to the show and I was standing in the front kind of, and in between songs, I yelled, oh, this goes together well. I hadn't thought about this in advance. I yelled, Roz Hudgens says hi. And Roz Hudgens is this really great German teacher at Hellgate High School, where we went to high school. And like the best teacher, you know, and I knew he would remember who she was. And he turned around, he got this weird look on his face, and he's like, that's my German teacher. Like, he was still in high school. And I was like, yeah, yeah. And then it was April Fool's Day. So he reached over and he grabbed this can and he turned aerosol spray and he turned to me and goes, want some fart spray? And he's like sprayed a whole bunch of fart spray in my face.
Oh, that's nice of him.
Yeah, it was nice. So I didn't take it personally, you know. It's, his reputation preceded him and it was fine. It was a great show.
Like all house shows are.
Yeah, yeah. Most house shows are good.
Yeah.
And then a couple years later, he actually came to the record store I worked at in Missoula, and somehow he knew who I was. I don't know. Someone had told him I worked there, and he apologized for being a dick to me, which I thought was great. And then, you know, a few years after that, we ended up recording our first thing with him. And then we were kind of locked into working with him and became big pals and stuff.
I read something somewhere about how he called into a show you guys were on.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true. We were on the radio. You know, what's funny is now that I think about it, we were on the radio at WNUR in Chicago and we were talking about Missoula and someone called in and it made some arcane reference to some Montana writer or something like that. And I was like, oh, yeah, yeah. Are you from Montana? And he was like, yeah. And then I kind of recognized his voice. And I was like, what's your name? And he said, he was Steve Albini. I'm like, oh, yeah, we went to the same high school, blah, 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 blah. And that, I don't think he even knows this. That was when we started thinking, you know what, we should go record with him next time we're in town. You know, I wonder what it would be like because, you know, at that point, you don't know, you know, if it matters if the person likes your music. Like we had hardly any experience being in a studio,
right?
So we did that. We recorded our first thing with him next time we came through town, and it sounded so great to us that that was it. You know, we just basically made records with Steve for the rest of our time with the band. Yeah,
which is not a funny. Horrible thing.
No, I mean it was a great match. You know, the one thing on the early records that we didn't do was we never really worked on the vocals at all. Like we just kind of like tried to get the band sound to be awesome. And we were making these records in like three and a half days, you know, just like soup to nuts from setting up to having the final mix on tape 3.5 right. days straight. So you'd work like 12, 14, 15 hours a day. And, that's the one thing that's sort of it has this typical thing of him supposedly not liking vocals or whatever, because we never had time to work on them. That's the only thing that I think would have turned out differently, maybe if we'd worked with someone else. But the records wouldn't have been as cool, and they wouldn't have sounded as awesome as they sound. They still sound great to me. You know, we've reissued a couple of them recently in the West and Libertine, and I think they're awesome. Libertine especially is just like, you know, for the swan song of that period of the band when we had four guys in it,
right.
That was a perfect capper. You know, it didn't feel like a capper at the time, but it ended up being one. And, you know, it's just, it's a great album. And he was a big part of that. Being able to capture what we were able to do as a group together, you know.
And spray you with fart spray.
And yeah, stuff like that. Yeah. Yeah. We were a good match also too, because like none of us cared. None of us gave a shit what anybody thought about us. And we came up getting, you know, ignored for so long. I mean, really a long time. Band started in 87 in Missoula without me. I joined the next year. And then in 94, and then we signed a Matador and for a record that came out in 96. That's 9 years, you know, for like the first 4, 5, 6 years of the band, almost nobody gave a shit. And so by the time we started working with Steve, you know, the last thing I cared about was if someone liked what we did or, you know, whatever. So we were a good match for him and on that front. You know, he could say whatever he wanted about anything. And
right. Really, and you'd just be like, whatever.
Yeah.
The typical Gen X attitude, right? Just whatever.
Okay. Well, it wasn't even whatever. It was just like, okay, that's great. Do you think that one's dumb? But I like it, so that's fine.
Exactly. And I think more creative people worry too. I think too many creative people worry too much what other people think, and that, because I think it matters at the end of the day is if you like it as the person who created something.
Yeah. And I also know, I mean, I know of a lot of bands that I know are objectively good that I don't really like. I don't really like listening to their music, you know, but I know it's good music. It's just, you know, whatever peculiarities go into my taste, whatever makes up my taste, it's not quite to my taste, you know, but it's
right.
It doesn't mean it's not good. So
right.
I totally get it if people don't want to listen to any of those records. They have a lot of personality, and if it's not your kind of thing, you know, that's fine. not a problem at all.
I want to bring up something that I'm sure you've been asked about before, but I'm not sure if you've ever been asked about it in this way. And that's okay. The end of Silkworm. And I know it was a very tragic ending. Mm-hmm. I don't want to comment too much on that. If anybody wants to talk about it or read about
it's
it.
All right.
I know. I just lost my mom about a year ago. So I know what it's like to lose somebody close. And I hate bringing it up for people, you know.
Okay. It doesn't. I'll talk about it as much as you want. It's fine.
When it happened, did you ever get the feeling that you were like, this is like it for me as a musician? Period, because you've been in Silkworm for so long, you know what I mean? And it was like, wow, this is
no. Andy and I didn't even discuss the fact that the band was over. It was so clear. You know, Michael was our drummer who died and was killed in the middle of what was it, July 7th, 2005. July 14th. We knew the band was finished because he was like half the band, you know, right. Live. Well, he was half of the sound of the band, and you can't. He was such a force behind the drums that you couldn't. There's no way to replace that, right? So, it would have been. Besides the fact it would have been gauche to do it, like just musically, it would have been disappointing. So we started playing again, you know, pretty quickly. Like within a couple months, we were jamming in my basement. And stuff. And it's surprising to me in retrospect, sort of that happened, but what else were we going to do? You know,
right.
And that then Bottomless Pit, I think played its first show maybe in November of that year, or maybe even earlier, maybe September. And I don't know, it just happened, you know, but I never thought about stopping playing music. I just knew that, you know, Silkworm was finished and that was it. You know, that was when Michael died, the band died, and that was all there was to it.
Right.
That made it even harder to get over, you know,
right.
Was the fact that I lost my buddy who's like a brother to me. And then also this band that had really, you know, guided my life over the last 15 years, you know, a really long time, was done. Just boom, like that. No thinking about it. And we thought about what it meant to continue doing what we did on a number of occasions when Matador dropped us or Touch and Go dropped us, you know. Or we were just eating shit in Seattle for 4 or 5 or 6 years. You know, we'd had to reckon with whether it was worth it a number of times. And we'd always decided, yeah, it was worth it. And then boom, it's just gone and you can't do it anymore. Yeah, it's pretty.
You were in Seattle though around the time of the grunge movement, right?
Oh yeah. Shit. We moved there in, 1990. So we were there. I can't remember. I think 10 and Nevermind came out the same year. And I think it was 91. Yeah, maybe. But yeah, we got there. We got there not too long before the guy Mother Love Bone died of a heroin overdose. That was like the first famous like junkie death in Seattle. And
That's crazy.
Well, it was a harbinger of many, obviously, to come. But yeah, I remember when that happened because we kind of knew some people in that whole circle and like second hand or whatever. Joel knew a couple of the girls better than we did, put it that way. But yeah, we were there for the whole thing. You know, when we moved there, of course, Mudhoney and Soundgarden and all that Sub Pop stuff was, you know, a big thing. Right. And, but on a countercultural level, it was a big thing. You know, the way SST, like the Meat Puppets and Minutemen and Husker Du were big to me when I was a kid. The kids were sort of into Mudhoney and Soundgarden or whatever in that way. So, and I thought that was it. You know, I thought this place is glutted with bands. It's not awesome. That aspect of it actually wasn't awesome. And then there was a kind of the subculture of bands that were all angling to get popular. Like, you know, they saw Queensryche or whatever these bands that were getting huge. And Mother Love Bone was one of those bands, like a tip for the top, going to be famous band. And then, you know, out of kind of almost out of nowhere, it seemed like Nirvana happened. You know, Pearl Jam rose out of the ashes of Mother Love Bone to be huge. But, you know, the whole Nirvana thing just changed the whole place. Well, Andrew for the worse, really.
Pearl Jam wouldn't be anywhere near what they were if Andrew Wood had died.
No, this is the only reason the band exists. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So, yeah, it was I didn't like it. You know, I thought the whole environment sucked kind of because it was like, there were a lot of places to play, but there were just so many bands and people were just angling the whole time for like record deals and shit. Just the stuff that I hated, you know, and we were in the wrong place. I mean, there's kind of I can't say it was a bad thing. We went there because that's where we met Michael, you know?
Right.
And that, like I said, by the time Joel was out of the band and like in like 95, 96, Michael was half the show. So it was like, that was awesome that connection was made. But as a place, Seattle was not our place. You know, Chicago was our place. San Francisco was more of our kind of place, you know.
Right.
So, but, you know, a lot of good came out of being there. It's a beautiful city.
When it's not raining.
When it's not raining, then it sucks. But I met people that I love, you know, there. So, there yeah.
See, I still love Pearl Jam, and I was never a huge Soundgarden fan or anybody. I mean, I love Nirvana too, don't get me wrong, but my favorite Sub Pop band sounded nothing like them, and it was Sunny Day Real Estate.
Oh, really? Yeah.
When I first heard Diary, I was like, I gotta hear more shit like this. And yeah. I had a buddy who was in a band that had access to all this stuff, and he was on a compilation with Jimmy World back in the day before Clarity came out, and I was like, wow, who's this is amazing, you know?
Yeah.
And they stopped being music like that. He went on to be like in a hardcore band, which is like, why? Why are you so angry, Mark? Relax. But Sunny Day Real Estate is what really changed my life. But then it opened up a lot of stuff for like Link and you know, bands like Silkworm. And so that's why when I started to really like, when I got older and stuff, I really started to appreciate a lot of the bands in the atmosphere of Silkworm as well as Silkworm, because if there's something where you listen to, you're like, oh yeah, I can, yep, this is, they were ahead of their time because they're speaking to 42-year-old me as opposed to 15-year-old me.
Yeah,
you know, 42-year-old me who has money to buy reissues, you know, and not 15-year-old me who's like, Mom, have some money.
Scrape up enough money to get a promo CD of it, yeah, for like $8 or whatever. Yeah, I think, I don't know. I think there was something about, I mean, there's something about the kind of music you're talking about that's very direct and very kind of strikes at the core of what it's like to be an adolescent or in your late teens or early 20s. And in a weird way, I feel almost like we were making music that was like, I mean, it was informed by stuff that wasn't contemporary to us for the most part. It was informed. There were a few bands like Bedhead, who I think were the best band of the 90s. So I love them very much and fortunate to be really good friends with those guys. But we were influenced by them, you know, or whatever. But most of the music we really were influenced by was older. And it wasn't, for the most part, kind of basic rock and roll. It was stuff like, you know, the Velvets or Bob Dylan, Neil Young, you know, stuff that was kind of shot through with this like sense of New Order, Joy Division, stuff that was had a sense of mortality to it, you know.
Right.
And so it wasn't, it was kind of removed from the more emo type of my life is like this thing. It's more, was more kind of, I don't know. It's weird because we were such an insular band in the way we operated, but I felt like our worldview was sort of cosmic, you know, in that we kind of pulled in stuff from all over the place as kind of triggers for what we wrote about or thought about when we were making music. We weren't generally thinking about ourselves, you know, exclusively or whatever.
Which can definitely tie a band down to like a time period and kind of date
it. It can, and I think that's one of the reasons I don't think that our music necessarily ended up being too tied to the time period. You know, that and honestly the way it's recorded. Like, I think the way Steve makes records is a pretty honest way of doing it. And if you're making music that's unique to you and you're not drawing on tropes from your contemporaries all that much, you know, I think it ends up being something that's going to be pretty durable probably over time. We weren't thinking about that at the time, but that's just the way it came out. And I'm glad it came out that way, you know.
I'm glad it came out that way too. Good. My ear holes, thank you very much.
Good.
Now let's go forward quite a bit, actually, because there's something I mentioned to Conan, and he said that when he talked to you last, he talked to you about it. And I have to talk to you about it because it's one of my favorite movies of the year it came out, and you did the soundtrack for The Girl on the Third Floor.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I am a big CM Punk fan, so I had to watch the movie. I went in with no expectations. I'm like, wow, this music's great, but I never really looked into it. And then I was like, wow, he's actually not that bad of an actor, and this is a good movie, and it's original, and it's not what, you know, a lot like Silkworm. It's very original, and it's not stuff that you hear or see every day. How did you get involved in that?
That was all Steve ALBINI, who he got asked by, I can't remember the name of the production company who made it. Trauma, maybe?
It's Snowfort, Travis Stevens.
Okay. Anyway, they asked Steve to make the do the soundtrack for it. And then Steve asked me and Allison Chesley, who is a cello player, plays under the name Helen Money. She's awesome. She's a really great musician, and she played, I mean, you've heard the thing, so you know what she does. But so anyway, he asked us if we'd make this record with him. Of course, we were both like, oh yeah, that sounds like a gas. Of course we're gonna do that. And then Steve, basically any of the longer pieces, he wrote those themes and made them up, and then we had to, you know, figure out what he was doing, which it was really interesting to play with him because we hadn't really played music before, you know, in a sort of regular capacity like that, at least. And his sense of timing and stuff is, you listen to it and it sounds sort of, you know, you're like, okay, well, that's his thing that he does. But, and I've since realized I have this about me too, for whatever reason, where it seems totally normal. But when you really dig into it and try to play it, you're like, wait a minute, what are you doing there? Like, it's like three notes, but there's some like weird hitch to it, you know? So it was really fun and interesting to sort of hear music through his ears and add in whatever I did to that. And then Allison just kind of classed the whole thing up because she's awesome and she can do whatever. But yeah, it was a lot of fun to make the record, and I think the album is cool. It's probably good for, you know, studying and stuff like that. People are in school, because there's no singing or anything on it, you know, no drums to distract you. But it was fun. It was fun to do, for sure.
Doing the incident first early, didn't you? Because you had to know what was going on, so you could.
Yeah, you know, the last podcast I actually was a green. Sort of, there's still green screen stuff in it, like for where like the guy's eye pops out when he gets hit with a bat or whatever. Like, it was just like a green blob. But doing the cues was really funny, because it's almost not. It's not even music. You know, you're just like, all right, this happens. Just going down the stairs and then gets hit in the head with a bat. So there's like 40 seconds of lead up and then, you know, the bat impact. So you're just making sounds that kind of like feed into collectively that feed into whatever you're watching on the screen. So it was interesting to do that, because I'd never done it before. You know, those little cue things were like, it's just sound effects basically. So it was a good experience. So I would do it any old time. He got a call from another movie that wanted him to do the soundtrack, and he's like, hey, we might have another job. And I was like, okay, great. And then I think they wanted him to do it for Exposure or something. Like, they were
not know who, like, Steve Albini is.
Yeah, they were like, oh, well, you'll get a lot of good Exposure from. So that didn't happen.
Yeah. Albini Exposure. Ladies and gentlemen, yeah. You've heard it here. That's just fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, it's funny.
That's like going up to Miles Davis. You know, I'm looking at the poster behind you. Like, hey, could you drop it on my record? It is, kind I can't of. Give you anything for it.
It is kind of, yeah.
That is really and nice.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, yeah, that was great, though. I really enjoyed doing it, for sure.
And you're still like making music to come out, right? You got more stuff, yeah, down the pipeline we can look forward to, yes?
Yeah, we so Mint Mile, my band, now made a album. Well, we've made a bunch of EPs, and then we made a double album that came out the month COVID hit. And it didn't impact it. It's sold out, so it didn't impact the
you harbingers of evil, you
sales. But we didn't get to play on it or anything. And then we'd played all the songs for a year anyway. But and then we have another, I don't know, album and a half, I think, or two records worth of songs that will start officially kind of recording and figuring out what to do with next month. Ideally, you know, we'll see. We'll see.
I mean, everybody can record at home now. You don't have to worry about. Yeah. That's the cool thing, you know. Is Steve going to be involved in the new record at all, or?
No, we record. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 engineers in the band. There's me, if you count me. Matt Barnhart, who plays bass, and he's a mastering engineer and recording engineer. He'll record the record. Jeff Pannell, who plays drums in my band, is can record stuff. And then Greg Norman, who works at Electrical, who's recorded a bajillion records. So we're pretty well covered there. Although I would like to just have Steve do it, actually, now that you mention it.
Have him just good, pass obviously. By it and be like, have him give it a listen and be like, you know, I don't like any of this. And you're like, all right, yeah, whatever. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah. We will record it at Electrical, but we record every practice at my house in case we get something good out of it. And like, we got one track that's like 10 minutes long. That's great. That is the take. I know, you know, and on our last record, we had two tracks, Great Combine. And, this thing, Amberlene, that's like 15 minutes long. Those were the first or second time we ever played those songs. And we just got them in my basement, because we record all of our practices. So that worked out really well. Yeah, every now and then lightning strikes and things work out like that.
Well,
you can do that now, you know.
Right, exactly. You can record your practice in such high quality that you could just release it if you want, and it won't matter.
It's cool.
I remember recording stuff on 4 tracks and be like, this is amazing. Yes.
Yeah, and then you listen back to it later, and it's usually not that amazing. But
no, it's like, can we redo this 20 years later? Is that okay? Yeah. You can find out more at your website, is just timmidyett.com. Right.
Yeah, that's not much of a website. It never gets updated. Mostly, I if I write stuff, it's on Twitter or Instagram, and I forget. It's either Midyett Tim or I think it's Midyett Tim on both of them. I can't remember.
I think your Twitter is, well, it'll all be in the description, but I think your Instagram Twitter is Tim Midyett. I don't know about
maybe
your Instagram,
so.
Though. Yes.
I think it's Midyett Tim on Instagram, yeah.
But stick around for just a second. Everybody, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to have a performance from last year where Tim played Great Combine, and it was great. So stick around. We'll be right back.
Hi, kids. It's your old pal, Cuddles, telling you not to drink and drive because you might spill your drink. Merry Christmas. We done? Good. Repeating lines, until the end of time. I try to find my place now. I can only put a song down on your face until the lighting falls. On what we wanted to bring. Not coming to me slow. But it don't feel wrong. Touched by thought.